Let's begin.
Burn, ungodly filth!
What do you want?
To make you ours or to make you despair?
Spirit Blade Productions presents...
Do you have any idea how much I will make you suffer? The horrific agony that I will inflict.
Spirit Blade. Dark Ritual.
Hell will be a refuge for you when I'm finished.
For more information, visit spiritblade.com.
ChristianGeekCentral.com.
Do you like games? I like games too. I like games too.
I want to take a few minutes and talk about the update for No Man's Sky titled Next. Now, if you're not familiar with No Man's Sky, I did do a trial and error review of the game when it came out in 2016. There was a lot of controversy around this game. It's basically intended to be an open world, and by that it should be understood open universe, or at least open galaxy, exploration and crafting and survival type of game. They were really hesitant when it released to define it succinctly as far as what this game was. And I think that led a lot of fans to just being very curious and hanging on every word that was said by the main developer, Sean Murray. And when he talked about the game, I think one of the mistakes that he made was he talked about it not like a trained PR person, but as a developer. And you might say, well, that sounds good, like he would be less PR speak and more about just being open and transparent. Well, that's true, and I think that what we saw of Sean Murray was him absolutely being himself and transparent, but I think what he wasn't communicating in all of that, when he would talk about the features that were going to be in the game, is that not all these features were going to be available at launch. That the concept of this game is that it would be very comparable to Minecraft, in that this basic version of the game would be released, and it would be a game that is constantly supported, constantly added to over the course of years, and fans who would play this game would be kind of figuring out for themselves what you could potentially do in this game. And that's why I think they didn't want to say very much about it, because the game is about exploring and figuring out what you can do in this galactic sandbox. So the way that the marketing and the PR was handled, I mean, Sony, I think, really should have had a proper PR person making the rounds instead of Sean Murray, or they should have properly trained him in how to communicate and set expectations properly. I could be wrong about this, because I know that there are pundits who have done a much more thorough examination of the things that Sean Murray said in his interviews. Maybe they are right to be as hard on him as they are. That's just not the impression that I got. I think that the things that were promised by Sean Murray to be in the game, many of them have been added since launch, but a ton of them were not there at launch, and so understandably the game was heavily criticized. And what they did for a while was, you know, in the midst of all this controversy, rather than kind of get up front and kind of explain what their plans were and stuff like that, Sean Murray, I think this is a controversial decision, but an understandable one, I think, from a certain perspective, decided to just not really talk about the game, but to mostly just vanish under the radar and get to work on it. I think that the thinking there was, all right, people are really, our word doesn't have much value after this perception that we've lied and not delivered on the promises that we made, and so why waste time, you know, just saying what our intentions are when people have already, you know, decided that we're not going to make good on what we say our intentions are. So they felt like the right move instead was to go quiet and to just spend all their time and energy getting those features that they had talked about before release into the game. And so a lot of people have just written off No Man's Sky. There was just a lot of anger. There's still among, you know, some people, a lot of just anger and nasty language going on the internet about this game, you know, and talk of too little, too late and stuff like that. Some people just really felt burned in a way that, like, seemed to profoundly affect them as only things in fandom can affect some of us. So, anyway, I think it's a bit of a cautionary tale, both for the developers and how they kind of handled the situation, and I think a cautionary tale for geeks and how we can react way too strongly to some things. Anyway, I guess that's open to debate, depending on, you know, the impressions that were given by, you know, the developers of No Man's Sky and stuff like that. I think a lot of people did get refunds, and so if they're still salty after getting their refund, you know, then I'm not sure how to help them. But anyway, fast forward now, 2 years almost, if not exactly, I don't know, right around 2 years, and there's been several big updates. But this is the largest one by far. And I have come back to No Man's Sky a few times before this big update because they'd added some neat features that I wanted to explore, you know. The basic gameplay loop is you start out on a planet and you have no ship. And you just have to kind of gather some resources to the point where you can repair a ship that you found and get, you know, more mobile around the planet and then actually get off of the planet so that you can explore other planets in the same system. And then eventually, as a result of exploring other planets and getting, you know, resources that maybe weren't readily available on your starting planet, you can get a warp drive and fuel your warp drive. And so there's this loop of exploring your environment, mining, you know, for components, and combining those components in various ways that you are kind of gradually spoon-fed blueprints and recipes for over the course of the game, so that you can, you know, build your ship, improve your ship, build and improve on your exosuit and your mining tool, which is also has multiple modes on it, so it functions also as a weapon against the aliens that might be nasty towards you. Most of them are quite peaceful. There are these mysterious robotic sentinels that are kind of like not quite spherical shaped things that have kind of almost a giant eye looking thing on them that are constantly monitoring and scanning and policing the environment. If they see you mining certain types of resources, they will get aggressive and they'll attack you and you have to get away, or they'll get reinforcements and it just escalates from there, kind of like a Grand Theft Auto, like an open world type of situation where if you anger the law enforcement, then the situation just escalates more and more, gets worse and worse, until you just have to escape and lower that kind of aggression level so you can come out of hiding again. So it has a lot in common with both Minecraft and some of those open city games, but it largely has had no story. With one or two of the major updates, they added some story elements. It's all text driven. I mean, the guys you're running into are all aliens anyway, so there is some voice performance or something, but it's all, and then you read the translation, you know. And it's interesting because you're also collecting words, you're collecting knowledge about these three different races that you encounter, and as you collect these different words, it will insert them into these opening dialogue statements that some of these aliens will make. And so, like, in the middle of gobbledygook, you'll get one word that you recognize that's in English in the text, and that represents you slowly learning their language over time, which really for me has taken a long, long time, and I still feel like I barely know anything. But thankfully, there are, you know, there's just that opening statement that's in gobbledygook, and then after that, there's kind of prose language that walks you through the sense that you're getting from what the alien wants, and then you enter into trade with them or whatever the interaction is going to be. So anyway, yeah, there's a lot going on in this game, but again, very little, like, in the way of story. One of the major updates did add some story elements, which was really nice. All just story maybe is a little bit too strong. No, there is some story, but the more important part for me was to have some kind of a quest line of some kind. And there, they've now beefed up the main quest line, which basically gives you the mission of exploring the universe until you reach the center of the galaxy, you know. And they've kind of like added some layers and richness to that. Last time I played it, it was before they'd done this kind of major update to flesh out that main quest line. So at that time, I was like one move away from the very end of the game. And then I set it down because I was like, oh, I don't quite want to finish off that quest line yet. And now picking it up with the next update, they fleshed out that quest before the next update, but I haven't played it since they, you know, updated it. But now coming back into it, it's like, oh man, they fleshed it out, and suddenly I'm not at the second to last step. I'm like somewhere way in the middle of that quest line now. There's clearly many other things that they're going to have me do, so, or collect or learn to build or whatever, and that's cool with me. One of the things that made me kind of like lose interest in the game after about only 10 or 20 hours the first time I sat down to play it was that I kept, like, I'd learned most of the recipes that I could learn for things. You know, you would explore an environment and find boxes or whatever, for lack of a better word, crates, or aliens who would give you information, and through doing that, especially interacting with aliens, you could get gifts of blueprints that would teach you how to craft new things. And there was one particular thing that I was really wanting to figure out how to craft, and I wasn't getting the blueprint for it, and in fact, instead, I was getting blueprints that I already had over and over and over again, and I just lost interest. I really like exploration in games, and that's the biggest selling point probably for this one, maybe right alongside the crafting and, you know, building things, and but without that component of like feeling like I could actually discover some new thing that I could build, or, you know, by interacting with the next alien on the next planet or whatever. Without that carrot dangling in front of me, I quickly lost interest. But coming back to this now, well, before I even get to next, man, I'm gonna have more to say, a lot more than I thought I would. I got back into the game probably about 3 or 4 days before the next update hit, and started seeing some of those updates for the main quest line, and also discovered all these other blueprints that I was able to get as gifts from interacting with aliens and stuff. And so already I was like, oh my gosh, this is really cool. I'm suddenly like back in this to win it, man. Oh my gosh. And so I was getting really excited for the next update. Which is weird to use it to say it like that. The update is called Next. No Man's Sky Next. But when you say it like the next update, well, of course it's the next update, you know. Anyway. Collect my thoughts. So I was getting back into the game, really having a great time with it, and the next update came, and oh my gosh. At first, I gotta tell you, I was a bit put off and really intrigued at the same time. I had really mixed feelings about it. First off, the biggest thing I was looking forward to is the visual overhauls that they were planning to bring to the game and that I feel like they really delivered on. First off, you can... Well, the big update I'm not gonna talk about is multiplayer. That's what most outlets are kind of shining a spotlight on, is, oh my gosh, you can play this game with your friends. But if you know me and my video game tendencies at all, you know I'm a big time hermit gamer. I'm not at all interested in multiplayer. In fact, the thing I was most curious about regarding multiplayer is, will it be forced on me? Will I have to get a PS Plus subscription? Will other players be able to muck about in my game and mess with my stuff when I don't want them to? And I've, as far as I can tell, the answer to that is, I don't have to deal with any of that crap. As soon as you load up No Man's Sky Next, you have the option of having a solo experience or having a multiplayer experience. I just checked my solo experience and just forgot all about the existence of multiplayer in this game. So I'm not going to talk about any of the multiplayer stuff. But the visual upgrades, you can play in third person now, whether you are walking around on the ground or in your spaceship. Prior to this, it's always been a cockpit view only in the spaceship or a first person view when you're on the ground. And I did discover that I really prefer to stay in first person and the cockpit view in both of those circumstances, but it's still cool, nice, it's still a nice feature and cool now and then to switch over to third person, just to see my guy, because you have all these customization options now for what race your person is and what their equipment looks like and the color scheme and, you know, tons of customization options. So that's been really cool. And then no customization options visually for your ship yet, but I wouldn't be surprised if that's coming. We'll see. And I found the ship harder to, not necessarily harder to control in third person, but you don't have the HUD when you're in third person view, so I couldn't keep track of how much thruster power I had left or how my shields were doing or how my, you know, my weapons were doing and stuff. And so that information I feel like is more readily available to me when I'm in the cockpit view, so I really stick to that. And then also in the third person view, there's still like some some targeting issues. I don't know, like you're still ultimately interacting with things based on where your reticle is in the center of the screen, not necessarily where your guy is or how he's facing. I ran into the same issue that I had to adjust to in Conan Exiles. So anyway, I still prefer first person, but really appreciate the visual overhauls. There's much more detail in the textures. The color palettes are a little bit more varied. They still have that kind of sepia tone kind of vibe to it, but with maybe not quite so super sepia. and it just has a more detailed look to it, and that makes exploration so much more enjoyable to me. Another thing that hasn't been talked about by anybody as far as I know, but I really appreciate, is they've changed the crunchy boot sounds. Oh my gosh, I'm so happy. I love those little Foley sounds of crunching boots in video games, and they were kind of stale and vanilla, you know, in the prior to this update. But that's one of the first things I noticed before I even took in all the visual updates. When I got out of my ship on a planet and my boots are going, I was like, oh my gosh, I'm so happy. So I've really been enjoying exploration a ton, but a huge downside of it has been they've changed all the elements and all the recipes and taken away a bunch of what I once knew how to do as a result. I'm having to kind of relearn a ton all over again. Like, okay, what element do I need to refuel my launch thrusters? Oh, I don't just need an element. I got to actually make something out of these other. Well, where are these elements? How rare are they? So I'm almost starting from ground level again in terms of figuring out what elements are rare, how easy it's going to be to get certain things, what are going to be my go-to places to find the elements I need in order to just get along in life, you know, in the world of No Man's Sky. And so I spent like an entire evening of playtime just kind of getting my feet wet again. And I think I can understand why they might want to do that. This is the first time now the game has been on Xbox One. And so maybe they're kind of wanting everybody, you know, in the zeitgeist to be kind of, in a sense, starting over and being kind of new at this, you know. Maybe that's, I don't, who can know? Who can know the minds of genius developers? But anyway, that initially was a big setback. But after about an evening of kind of like, you know, pushing through it and feeling totally like a beginner again, I'm feeling like I'm getting back into a groove and getting to know the world again and figuring out what my next steps are. And I'm really enjoying the survival aspect, like this feeling of being on this hostile alien world where if I take off my helmet, I'm dead. And you can't take off your helmet, but you know, just that sense that I was talking about in the Europa Report movie, where it's like we are so freaking fragile, and you just have an awareness of that with all the various weather conditions, too hot, too cold, poisonous, toxic, water, whatever the thing is that you got to survive in, you know, you're constantly having to adapt and figuring out, you know, what you need to be picking up as you're walking around to constantly be replenishing the things that keep you alive, you know. And so I am enjoying that more now than I did the first time I sat down to, before it felt a little bit like a nuisance. And this time around, I don't know, there's something that feels somehow pioneering to me about the survival aspect. I don't know if that's something about the game that's changed, or if that's something in me as a gamer and my tastes and interests that have changed in the last 2 years. So, but I am really, really enjoying myself with this game now. I feel like I'm just about ready to pick up where I left off. I still need to reconstruct the base that I had in the previous version. They had to, just because they were reseeding and rebuilding kind of the entire universe, they had to archive everyone's bases, but they give you kind of the equivalent technology and resources when you start out that you lost from before. They kind of translate and, you know, all of your equipment that you'd had into roughly the equivalents to kind of get you back on track. But there is kind of an adjustment period if you've had a saved game where you have to kind of get yourself resituated again and back to kind of the status quo you had before. So I'm right now in the middle of reconstructing the base that I once had, and I had some workers in there, some specialists, one a weapons specialist and one a construction specialist and one, I think, like a technology specialist. And each one of those I had little quest lines from. And all of those things are coming back online. Once I rebuild that part of my base, then that specialist just kind of re-inhabits that part of my base instantly, and the quest line is able to pick up again right where it left off. And so that's what I'm doing right now. And it might sound like, oh, that's a pain in the butt, Peter, but I'm actually enjoying it. I'm enjoying the reconstruction of the base that I lost, you know, which I'm sure a lot of players are initially frustrated about the loss of those bases. But I think most players are going to be able to reconstruct that. And then I'm going to be off to the races again with the quest lines I left off, and also the new quest lines that I'll be able to pick up now. The one thing that I'm concerned about, and this is the big unknown, is what will happen if I get to a point where I have a question about some element that I don't know where to find it, and I can't find that answer online. I think one thing that's helped me coming back to No Man's Sky, even before the next update, was playing Monster Hunter World and just getting used to the idea of playing a game that doesn't give you all the information you want in order to progress through it. And that you are gonna really, at least if you're a player like I, you know, a crappy player like I am, you're gonna need to take advantage of online resources and communities and wikis and stuff like that in order to figure out, okay, how do I get the Atlas Pass version 2? Because nobody's spelling that out for me, you know, so you gotta find that answer online. Well, the way that you get the Atlas Pass version 2 or version 3 or some other thing has all dramatically changed overnight. And so all of this information that had been building over the last 2 years in these online communities on how to find certain elements, like, where do I find this? What kind of planet is it on? Okay, what kind of plant or spot am I looking for? Is it going to be in a cave type environment? Or do you know, all these kinds of tips that people could tell you so that you could have a real idea of what it is you're looking for instead of just wandering aimlessly for who knows how long before finding what you want. They may not be available as fast as I want them to be. Now, so far, they have been. So far, I think there are many more much more hardcore No Man's Sky players than I am, who are not only playing the game, but are sharing their knowledge online, and they are way ahead of me, you know, and so I think that me just playing, you know, maybe a couple hours a night, each night, I'm still going to be well behind the wikis as they're being reconstructed to compensate for all the major changes. But if I'm wrong about that, that would be a significant roadblock for me that I think would take me out of the game again for a while. And so that's the big question I have in my mind, you know. I have put, before the No Man's Sky next update came, I was surprised to learn I'd put 60 hours into the game, so only about 20 when it first came out, and then with one or two of the larger updates, I put in, you know, maybe a dozen or more hours in each of those times before kind of losing interest again. And so my big question is, will this update be the one that really gets its hooks into me and makes this like a Skyrim type experience, or like what Monster Hunter World has been becoming? In other words, an experience that is going to be over 100 hours, in fact, likely hundreds of hours, you know? Is that what this game is going to become? And that would be really cool if it had that kind of staying power. And I think it has the potential for that, just with all the little side quests that you can now pick up to basically just, you know, do jobs for different guilds and stuff like that and get rewards from them. Something as simple as that. I don't need a big story, just kind of like a reason to go out and get X and bring it back, you know. I just need that. And if they can keep doing that, and if they can keep a variety of elements to discover and blueprints to build, you know, I know that there's a ton of stuff. I haven't even gotten into building a land roving vehicle, which you can buy and build like massive tracks for, and I haven't bought a freighter yet that you can, you know, and you can, people have fleets. They have starship fleets that they own in this game. And that they send out on missions. There is like so much in this game that I haven't even tapped into yet. So I have good reason to believe that I think it is going to be now, especially for me, someone that has only kind of dipped into it, you know, a few times since the initial launch. I think there's just so much to discover here, and I just can't wait to find out if it's going to play out like I think it will. The other thing that's really interesting, that's going to interest me, and I'm not planning on making, you know, this audio content as a video. I think I'll just leave it as content for the podcast. But one thing I might make a video on, we'll see how it plays out, is what the language is around the studio Hello Games and Sean Murray and No Man's Sky. I hear the word redemption a lot, or redeemed. Has Sean Murray redeemed himself? Has the game, No Man's Sky or Hello Games, have they redeemed themselves? And you know, that always catches my interest because it just seems to be ingrained into us in our broken brains, this idea that we can redeem ourselves, self-redemption, you know? That is the thing, that is the standout belief from Christianity, I think, that makes it, not the only one, but a very striking one, that makes it hugely different from other philosophies and worldviews, you know? It almost, you could argue, is evidence for the fact that it is not, it's the one non-man-made religion, because it's got this component in it that is just alien to our natural thinking, alien to other worldviews, and that is that we don't redeem ourselves, we can't redeem ourselves. That really, as free creatures living in service to a holy God who made us for his purposes, what we rightly owe him is perfect obedience, perfect love toward him, toward others around us, perfect consideration of others and their needs, their wants, their concerns, their preferences, perfect self-giving, self-sacrificing love and consideration for others. And that's where you could argue that Sean Murray and Hello Games and Peter Franson have failed. You know, when we kind of call them little accidents, oh, I made a mistake of communication. Well, you know what? Honestly, if we spent less time entertaining ourselves and more time contemplating how we could better communicate and better be thoughtful toward others, if we had it in us to do that, then I think we wouldn't be making these kinds of communication blunders that honestly, in many, many cases, could be avoided if we just committed to prioritizing different things in our lives, you know, but we don't, and so this stuff happens. And so all that to say, really, in being made by a holy God for his holy purposes, what we owe him every day is perfection. What we owe him every day is absolute allegiance. And so we can't, like, make up for yesterday's rebellion by obeying perfectly today, because we already owe perfect obedience to this holy God who made us for his purposes, that we said, screw you two, I want to do life my way. You know, and so we can't redeem ourselves. We need him to redeem us. And so I'm just always interested to see kind of what's the language going to be? What's going to show up about how people view themselves, their rights, what they are entitled to? There's all kinds of like moral language, virtue language that comes out of these controversies that I think is really telling about what the natural mentality, the natural perspective is among people and among us when we don't allow the Holy Spirit and the Word of God to correct us. So I'm going to be keeping an eye on that conversation and seeing if it's even one that's generated in the mainstream games media. But anyway, that's all I have to say about it for now. I'm not ready to say that I recommend this game, but I recommend it to me. I'm having a great time and hopefully will continue to do so.
Let's begin.
Burn, ungodly filth!
What do you want?
To make you ours or to make you despair?
Spirit Blade Productions presents...
Do you have any idea how much I will make you suffer? The horrific agony that I will inflict.
Spirit Blade. Dark Ritual.
Hell will be a refuge for you when I'm finished.
For more information, visit spiritblade.com.